welcome to the eighth day of this Spanish part of the 2015 Winter Universiade, the sights of the Sierra Nevada a wonder to behold as the sun continues to shine on Granada. Coming up, a small Asian clash in the women's ice hockey tournament as Japan and China jockey for position at the top of Group A. And it's hammer time in the men's curling. Sweden and Canada going face to face, knowing the winners would have one foot in the semi-finals. Start with the women's ice hockey and the final game from Group A, which saw China and Japan face off at Milhashen Pavilion with top spot in the group at stake. The Chinese have impressed in Spain, starting with a 2-1 win over the USA in their opener, then thrashing the hosts 12-0, leaving them flowing with confidence ahead of this crunch encounter. Fang Jin, Kong Minghui and Yu Zijin, all with 3 goals apiece thus far. Meanwhile, the Japanese started their campaign in Granada with an 11-0 mauling of the Spanish before facing off against the USA. They'd already beaten them 2-0 at the last Universiade in Trentino and again prevailed against the Stars and Stripes, this time by 4-1. So the two unbeaten teams from the group going head-to-head. It's simply a match to decide who plays Russia and who plays Canada in the semi-finals. The Japanese looking to get forwards right from the off. Ayaka Toko with the early shot, which Wang Yuqing was unable to handle. Haruna Yonayama then steamed in to try and put away the rebound, but could only flick the puck straight at the Chinese goaltender. Japan showing their usual speed in attack as well. Toko this time playing a 1-2 in mid-rink before scooping a long pass harmlessly into the hands of Wang. Indeed, the Japanese finding it hard to break down a determined defensive wall from the Chinese. This time, Moeko Fujimoto attacked down the right. The dogged defence from Zhao Qinan put her off her shot just in the nick of time. Japan continuing to try and work the puck around, this time getting in behind the net before setting up the shot for Mei Mori. Her effort well parried by Wang. Runa Moritake on the follow-up, but also unable to beat the goaltender with a cunning reverse flick. China mostly hemmed into their own third of the rink, but occasionally offering a glimmer of hope in attack. Zhang Menqing and Kong Minghui combining nicely here. The initial shot going wide, with Kong's follow-up also well saved by Nana Fujimoto. That seemed to bolster Chinese confidence too. On the attack again, this time He Jin finding space on the left but not doing enough with that flick shot. So Japan's ability to turn defence into attack at pace rather defined their style in Spain. Moeko Fujimoto this time adding the cutting thrust. Turn flick well saved again by Wang. A rather curious incident with just over 3 minutes remaining in the opening period. The lights shutting down as the teams prepared for a face-off, the officials thus deciding to end the first period then and there and extend the second by 3 minutes and 8 seconds. So with the lights back on, Japan continued to probe for an opener, having taken the shot count 18-4 in the opening period, this time keeping the puck well before Sena Suzuki's slap shot was well held by Wang. The Japanese had to be careful though, as the Chinese were itching to get on the front blade when they could. Yu winning the puck in midfield and driving forward. Fujimoto showing great concentration with her handling. The Japanese getting closer and closer to a breakthrough though, again getting in behind the China goal. Asami Ohashi bringing the puck round in front of the net while swinging her shot in. That's one well parried. Moritake with the rebound, but also blocked, triggering a bit of a free-for-all until Wang eventually killed the puck. So Japan by now monstering the shot count, 38-8 by the end of the second period. The match still goalless though, and it continued in the same vein in the final period. The Chinese penalty count also on the up. Shiori Koiki and Ayaka Toko exchanging passes during a power play, the former taking the shot in the end. The puck falling loose, but beaten away by desperate Chinese defending. The opening goal had to come, and it did so with just over 12 minutes left to play. Suzuki with all the time in the world to line up a shot from near the blue line. Again, Wang unable to hang on to the puck, and that allowed Mori to nip in and tuck away her first goal of the tournament. That no less than a dominant Japanese side deserved. Penalties really hurting the Chinese under pressure, who had both Yu and Wen Lu in the penalty box. The Japanese finally took the lead. The Japanese delighted to finally find the back of the net. Stubborn Chinese defence eventually beaten. And even when a goal to the good, the Japanese continued to search for a match-ending second. Mori with another shot parried. Yui Matoya's follow-up again saved by the impressive Wang. China unable to find a way back into the match then. Japan bossing the shot count by 56-14. Fully deserving their 1-0 victory. And with it, taking top spot in Group A. That win sees Japan through to the first semi-final on Wednesday, where they'll face defending champions Canada, having been humbled 15-0 by the Canucks in the last four in Italy back in 2013. Meanwhile, China play Russia in the second semi-final, that after the Russians beat Canada 3-1 in their top-of-the-table clash in Group B on Sunday night. To the Fuentenueva Pavilion, where the men's curling competition is getting very interesting indeed. This is the 8th of 9 sessions. Canada and Sweden going head-to-head here, both with a 4-3 record, and knowing that a win here could be vital if they were to move to the semi-finals later in the week. A loss could see them bow out in the earlier stages. Well, straight into the action in the first end then. This the first stone from Swedish skip Patrick Mabergs. There's a guard in short here. He's just trying to draw around that and into the button. Doing so beautifully as well. Not too much sweeping needed. That stone could not have been more accurate. So the pressure on Canadian skip Matt Dunstan then with his final stone of the end. He's going for pace this time, trying to hit the front guard and clear out those stones in the house. It nearly came off too, but that red stone there, rather confusingly the Swedish stone despite their yellow kits, already scoring now with a simple draw to the button, 4-2 on the opening end. No mistake either from Mabergs. Lovely pair to start the match in a 2-0 lead. This is the same Swedish quartet that went to the 2013 Junior World Championships, where they did come up against Matt Dunstan, but a Canadian with a different team at his back. Sweden beat Canada in the round robin of that competition, but then were beaten by the Canadians for the bronze medal. Looking for revenge here then. Canada took a single in the second end for a 2-1 lead for the Swedes. No score in the third, onto the fourth then. That's the first stone from the Swedish skip. Nudging that Canadian stone right out of the house, but losing his own as well. So a last stone for Dunstan. Four Canadian stones guarding the front of the house. Just looking to swing out to the right and catch that Swedish stone there. Unfortunately, he misses his contact. A big mistake from Dunstan. So the Swedes already sitting two in the house, now with the relatively simple task of just drawing this around on the right. Pace looking good. He would just rest up against his other stone here. Contact not too much. Big three for Sweden and a 5-1 lead after four ends. Canadians again could only muster a single with the hammer in the fifth end. Onto the sixth end with the Swedes 5-2 up. First stone for Mabergs. Draw out to the left. Swinging round that first guard. Perhaps just a little short of pace. Swedes, though, sitting two. What can Dunstan come up with? He's going to go for pretty much the same shot. Sweeper really working hard on this one as well. Just swinging round. Would like that to have gone a little further, in fact. This end now all about, but Mabers can see enough of that Canadian stone to take it out, going with pace.
Stop!
Just avoiding his own stone, taking out the Canadian. Another pair for Sweden. And already in a 7-2 lead after six ends. Another single for the Canadians in the seventh. Not really enough. 7-3 down going into the eighth end. It's the last stone for Dunstan. Really under pressure. Needs to make a steal against the hammer. Trying to draw this one in to the button. And that really not quite good enough. Leaving Mabergs with a simple takeout here to really put this match to bed. A superb performance this from the Swedes. An easy takeout, another three for them, and a 10-3 victory. Canadians giving up with two ends left to go. That means that Sweden now with 1 foot in the semi-finals with a 5-3 record. If they beat the Czechs in their final game, they will definitely be in the last four, as will the British if they beat the Swiss in their last game. All the Canadians can do is beat Japan in their last match and hope either the British or the Swedes slip up.
When education meets sport and culture, what best promotes excellence in mind and body? Where do friendship, integrity, and achievement meet? Which event gathers the best student athletes from around the world? The Universiade, the home of international university sports. Today's stars, tomorrow's leaders.